All right. Before we get started, I want to remind you guys that we encourage you to bring your Bibles to church so you can underline and highlight things, some points that impress you, and to bring a journal to take notes so that you can go back during the week and review the sermon, because what this helps us to do is to really meditate and chew on the Word so that it sinks deeper into our hearts and transforms us. And if you don't have a Bible and you'd like to follow along, there are Bibles on the table in front of each of the cry rooms, and you can use that during the message. Put it back when you leave, but if you don't have a Bible, feel free to take one as a gift to you from the church. All right? And we shake your head, say, okay, Kirk. Just want to keep reminding us, because that's really one of the great tools that I think helps us to grow deeper in our faith, as we're growing disciples to reach the unreached through going through the book of Romans. Okay, well, in the message today, I'm going to talk about issues that are moral dilemmas in our life. And what I mean by our moral dilemma, let's use our imagination and think that we're living in Europe in the late 1930s, and you have a neighbor that is of Jewish descent. And you've become great friends over the years. Nazi comes and Germany comes and is occupying your country and is requiring anyone of Jewish descent to wear a yellow star. And many of them are being arrested and are disappearing with many rumors of what's happening to them. This Jewish friend comes to you in the middle of the night, knocks on your door, and he asks for you to find a way to help his family to hide and escape. What do you do? That's a moral dilemma, isn't it? Do you obey the authority of the governments that are over you, or do you, in a sense, rebel and take your friend and hide them out and find a way to get them to safety? What do you do if you're living in the 1940s in the United States, and just because you're from Japanese descent, you're required by the government to take care of all of your personal affairs in 24 hours, and you're allowed only one suitcase of possessions of each person in your family, and you're being required to report to the train depot the next day, and you know you're going to be carted off and put in a relocation camp and incarcerated just because you're of Japanese descent. Do you act like the Japanese people and say shikata gannai, meaning it can't be helped, and you willfully submit even though you lose everything you have? Or what if you're of a different color, that your skin is black because you're from African descent, and you're being persecuted, and you're being segregated, that you have to use certain restrooms, and you can only drink from certain water fountains, and you're required to go to different schools, and you're not given the rights and the privileges of other people just because they're white? And so what do we do in those situations? Do we become like a person like Dietrich Bonhoeffer, that in Germany he spoke out against Hitler and the terrorism of the Nazi regime, and he was arrested by the SS, and he was put in a concentration camp, and he was martyred. He was hung 1 week before the Allied forces came in and freed the people from the camps. Or you could be like Martin Luther King, that you begin to speak out, that you promote civil disobedience in a peaceful way so that you can bring civil change in the country, so that people of different races and different colors can have the same opportunities and the same rights and equality as people that are white. Perhaps you can be like Gandhi, that peacefully leads a whole country into what he called Quit India in 1942, and led India into freedom from being controlled by England. So the question that I want to throw out there, is there a place, is there a line that we can draw in the sand that kind of says, you know, from a biblical perspective, this is where we say we're not going to take it anymore. Do we have that right? And the one thing that is clear in this text that we're looking at from Romans 13 is God wants us to understand that he is ultimately the one in control. And so what I want us to begin to understand, and this is a challenge for everyone in this room, is we need to develop a kingdom of God worldview versus a political worldview. And so regardless of what political party you stand with, this message has something to say to every one of us in this room. Okay? So we need to make that clear. So we have our forefathers. Well, my forefathers weren't here. Many of yours were. In the 1700s, when the colonies were established and England was still controlling and taxing the people in the Americas, and the people decided to stand up against that, and the Revolutionary War stood. Did they have a biblical justification to do that? Maybe there's the Tea Partiers, that you are standing up against big government, and you're standing up to promote giving the control back to the people and minimizing government control and desiring for the government to be held accountable fiscally. Maybe you are like the Wall Street occupiers, that you're standing up and you're protesting and you're wanting equality socially and economically in the country instead of such distinct classes between the rich and the poor. And, you know, quite honestly, the elephant in the room is, what happens if you're from a particular party that doesn't agree with who is in office at the highest level in our country? How do you freely make a point to express your concerns and your desires of what you'd like to see happen? So as we look at Romans 13 here, we need to first of all understand that from a cultural and a historical perspective of what Paul is saying here, Paul is speaking to an audience that is primarily of Jewish descent that have chosen to follow Jesus. To the Jewish culture, they saw any kind of government over them as being a pagan influence. And so the Jews would, their MO was that they would isolate and they would kind of sequester themselves in their little cloisters of a Jewish community, and they really wanted to let the rabbis speak into them and control what they do and how they handle things judiciously in their little Jewish community. So what Paul is talking about here in Romans 13 is really, this is radical. This is a totally different perspective that Paul is giving here that most of the Jewish people would not accept very freely. To most of us, this is like, oh, well, this makes sense, and this is just confirmation to how you live your life. But there are others that say, man, I never really considered what Paul is saying. So let's look at this and see that, first of all, in Romans 13, verse 1, Paul is talking about earthly authorities that are God's agents of law and order in our lives. Verse 1 says, let everyone be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority, listen to this, except that which God has established. The authorities that exist have been established by God. So Paul is calling anyone that's a follower of Jesus Christ to be responsible citizens. And this means we're called to be submissive, are subject to the people that are in authority over us in government positions. This word subject comes from a Greek word that means it's a description of a military attitude of voluntary deference to the wishes of another. So if you're a private in the army and your corporal, sergeant, lieutenant, whatever above you tells you to go out on this field and run that way, you have to submit and do what they tell you to do to be a good soldier. This is the same wording that Paul is using, that we should willfully submit to those in authority over us, because who has put them in position is God. That's that kingdom of God worldview, that God sovereignly places kings and kingdoms in place, and he calls us to submit to them, that God is in control. And we even see this in the Old Testament. In Jeremiah 25, Jeremiah the prophet is speaking of what's going to happen to Israel because of their rebellion. In verse 8, it says, "Therefore, the Lord Almighty says this, because you have not listened to my words." That's a scary thought of what happens when we don't listen to God's words. He says, "I will summon all the peoples of the north, and my servant Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, declares the Lord." See, he says, my servant, King Nebuchadnezzar, he wasn't a Jewish person. And he says, "And I will bring them against this land and its inhabitants, and against all the surrounding nations. I will completely destroy them and make them an object of horror and scorn and an everlasting ruin." And so that actually happened, that Nebuchadnezzar brought his armies from Babylon. They came into Israel. They totally destroyed Jerusalem, burnt down the temple, and they took the Jews into captivity. Now, Nebuchadnezzar himself got very prideful and rebellious, and look at what happens in Daniel 4:31. It says, "The words were still on his lips when a voice came from heaven. This is what is decreed for you, King Nebuchadnezzar. Your royal authority has been taken from you. You will be driven away from people and will live with the wild animals. You will eat grass like cattle. Seven times will pass by for you until you acknowledge that the Most High is sovereign over the kingdoms of men and gives them to anyone he wishes." So what Scripture is very clear is whoever is in authority or in rule of governments has been put there and established there by God himself. And when their rule is over, God is the instrument that takes them out. So as a general rule, what he's saying here is that we should always subvert and be under the authority of our governments above us. And he says the first reason of this is it's what the government is what God uses to establish law and order in our land. And so the classic novel, The Lord of the Flies, is really a very clear picture of what life could be like without government. Without government to keep order with laws of the land, and without the punishment of those who don't follow the law. Is that these young boys on an island, there's no law, there's no authority, and so they take it upon themselves and anarchy breaks out. That it's survival of the fittest. They begin to fight against each other, and the strongest one is the one that is able to lead others in revolt against the other group. And that's what life would become in an area or a country or a territory where there's no laws that govern the land. When we were in Haiti 2 years ago, Haiti, before the UN was sent in to establish control in Haiti, was an anarchist country. That there, the laws didn't mean anything. And there, the gangs and were coming in and were totally taking over. And so the UN came in and took out the leaders of these gang leaders. So then he talks about civil obedience that allows us to fear God and not man. We see this in verse 2. It says, "Consequently, whoever rebels against the authority is rebelling against what God has instituted. And those who do so will bring judgment on who? On themselves. For rulers hold no terror for those who do right, but for those who do wrong. Do you want to be free from fear of the one in authority? Then do what is right, and you will be commended. For the one in authority is God's servant for your good. But if you do wrong, be afraid. For rulers do not bear the sword for no reason. They are God's servants, agents of wrath, to bring punishment on wrongdoers. So it's obvious that when we choose to rebel against our governing authorities, when we choose to act against the laws of our land, he says, fear, because you will face God's judgment and wrath and punishment because he established the laws of the land through the governments that he's allowed to be in place. So you want to live peacefully among each other? You want to live peacefully in the land? Then follow the law. It's plain and simple. You know, so the best example of this is, do you want to live in peace 100% of the time in your life? Do you live in peace when you get behind the wheel of a car? Or are you living in fear whenever you're driving? You're always looking to make sure no one's hiding around the bush with a radar gun, right? You're always looking in the rearview mirror, make sure that no one's coming after you with the lights going. See, that's fear because you know you're not following the law. And so if you want to live at peace at all times, then don't speed. Oh my gosh, it's so simple. I kind of stretched a little bit because I asked the officer, I said, so how much do you allow over? 5? 10? Have you ever been in front of a judge in court? It's funny because I used to be a case manager, and I worked with juvenile delinquents with an agency called Jacob Center that used to be here, and it's now another name that they are under. But we did this thing that we took these group of juvenile kids that had been in trouble with the law. We took them to this kind of scared straight kind of program that was at Territorial Prison in Canyon City. And this is when I was living here. And so there was this one kid that in particular was just trouble. We knew this kid was not listening to anything we were trying to do with him. So I watched this kid, and we go into this room, and there's a select group of inmates that are at high level and are trained in this program, and they walk in, and they're speaking to these young guys, and they're really trying to help them to see reality of where these guys are going. And this one guy that we took, he just stood up and just was challenging them. You could see the look on his face like, I'm not afraid of you guys. And this big, huge inmate, I mean, this guy was a monster. He goes up to him, and he gets this far in his face, and he's screaming at him. And he says, you think you're tough. If you were in here, you'd be mine. And if that was me, I'd be, oh! I just crumble to the ground, but he would not break down. And when we left there, the probation officer and I, we were kind of talking about this kid, and we said, that kid's going to end up there. And he did. Now, on the other side of this is there was a group of Japanese students that came into Colorado Springs from Okinawa. And I knew their pastor, and he said, hey, is there anything unique we could do with these kids in Canyon City? And I went, oh, yeah. So I worked it out that we did the same thing with these Japanese students, and we went into Territorial Prison. And I remember they say, okay, walk into this room, and they're walking. They didn't know, but behind the big metal door goes and shuts, and you can see the kids go, oh. And so they're talking to a person that works for DOC, and she was talking to them, and I was watching this. This was really fun. And so, and I know I'm sick, but they're listening to this woman talk, And in the back, quietly, these six of these inmates come in. I mean, they were intimidating, scary looking. And so the woman says, now I want you guys to turn around. So the kids turn around and they go, whoa! And these guys spoke to these kids just like they talked to these juvenile delinquents that came. And afterwards, those kids go, I am never going to break the law. I'm never going to end up in there with those guys. Because they had a healthy fear. You see, I think that what Paul is talking about here is if you have a healthy fear and respect of the law, follow it, and you don't need to live in fear. God wants us to live with freedom. He wants to live with liberty, and that comes with us obeying the law of the land as well as the Word of God. You see this? So then he talks about civil obedience allows us to live above reproach. And this is one of the things that I think is really important for us to believe. If we are truly followers of Jesus Christ, it is horrible for our witness if we're not following the law. And he says, therefore, it is necessary to submit to the authorities, not only because of possible punishment, but also as a matter of conscience. This is also why you pay taxes, for authorities are God's servants who give their full time to governing. Give to everyone what you owe them. If you owe taxes, pay taxes. If revenue, then revenue. If respect, then respect. If honor, then honor. So God wants us to have a clear conscience. And if you're doing something right now that you know is not what the law is prescribing you to do, you're not having a clear conscience right now. And so God wants you to have that. He wants you to have a spirit of peace within, and it can only come by God transforming our heart and our attitude towards those in authority. You see, remember what I said about the background of this historically of the Jews and how they really were struggling with paying taxes to Caesar, that they didn't want to give their money to a pagan leader, but Jesus paved the way. He really, totally blew up their paradigms. In Matthew 22, when he was approached by some religious rulers and say, Jesus, what should we do in paying taxes to Caesar? In Matthew 22, 18, it says, but Jesus, knowing their evil intent, says, you hypocrites, why are you trying to trap me? Show me the coin used for paying the tax. And they brought him a denarius. It's a Roman coin. And he asked them, whose portrait is this? And whose inscription? Caesar's, they replied. Then he said to them, give to Caesar what is Caesar's, and to God what is God's? It is interesting what Jesus is talking about here is basically all of us are indebted to two things in life. These are two things that we should always do. First and foremost, he's saying if you owe taxes, pay your taxes. Regardless of how much you agree or disagree with how much taxes you're being required to pay, you need to pay them because those taxes are going to those that God is using to govern our land and establish law and order. The second thing that we owe is our tithe to God. So what he's saying here is give the 10% that is due to God, be sure and give it to God because that's his, not ours. And so when we follow those principles, I believe as our conscience is clear, it helps us to grow spiritually, it helps us to grow emotionally, and it helps us to grow relationally when we're managing our life and living our life the way God prescribes us to live. Now, it's interesting. As the Jews were in captivity in Babylon, listen to what Jeremiah now says in Jeremiah 29, verse 6. He says, also, seek the peace and prosperity of the city to which I have carried you into exile. Pray to the Lord for it, because if it prospers, you will prosper. And so what He's saying here, Jeremiah is, pray for those that God has established in authority. Because if things go well for them, it just translates down to things go well for us. Now, if you ever want to get a good perspective on things here, and I'm talking in particular about living in the U.S., is you need to somehow, some way, go on a short-term mission trip someday to a third world country. Whether it's in South America, in Africa, in Southeast Asia, it doesn't matter, but you need to go. Because what happens is when you see the way life is in those countries, you will forever be thankful for what we have here. When we went to Haiti a couple years ago, I mean, I've been to Thailand, and Thailand, it was poor, but it was nothing like going to Haiti because of the social chaos of that country. And, you know, it's you just have the smell of raw sewage going down the gutters constantly. You see trash everywhere, literally everywhere. There was a river in the city that was totally, completely full and probably 3 feet deep of plastic containers that were thrown in the river as trash. There's no infrastructure there that the electricity wouldn't come on for maybe 5 minutes a day. And so you hear generators going everywhere because that was their only means of having electricity. And then we had to have an armed guard with us at all times because of the danger of being robbed, of being assaulted. And so when we saw the UN forces going around in their big trucks and stuff, it's kind of like, phew, I'm glad the UN is here. But we don't have life like that, do we? But that's what it's like to them. That's normal to them. But Romans 12, 18, this is a challenge for us. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. And how do we live at peace? By following the law of honoring and respecting those in authority of our land. We're called to honor and respect anyone in any government office. Now, I just think it'd be great for us to do that this morning. And I just want to acknowledge Josh Erkman. Josh, where are you, bro? Stand up, Josh. Josh is leaving tomorrow to go serve in the Navy for 6 years. And so we want to pray for Josh this morning as he's doing that. And anyone else that serves in any government occupation, would you please stand because we want to pray for you. Josh, go ahead and keep standing. Anyone serves any government, police officer, any city, county government, federal government, would you please stand? And we want to honor you and give you respect and pray for you. Okay? God bless you guys. Let's pray for these guys. Lord, we thank you for these men and women that are standing, and we just want to pray your blessing over them. We pray that you would give them wisdom and that you would give them the authority that you have passed down to them to follow the law of the land, to be able to create order and be able to protect the freedom that we live in as people in America. And God, we just want to pray a special blessing for Josh as he goes into the Navy. Lord, we pray that you would be with him, that you would always speak to him, that your presence would always be with him. And Lord, use Josh as a light, as your representative with those other guys that he will spend 6 years with in the Navy. And we thank you for guys like Josh that are willing to say, Lord, I'll lay my life down for you. So we pray your blessing over him, and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you guys. God bless you, Josh. You see, so what God gives us in America is he gives us the ability to be positively engaged with our government. If you don't agree with a decision that's being made by public officials, you have the right and the great privilege to